Hello and welcome to Week 46's Gameplay Podcast. We are here to discuss the EA Sports FC 25 gameplay pitch notes. And I have a panel of guests with me who are pretty expert on gameplay and I know have been taking a look at these pitch notes and have some insight to share on what they've seen. And we'll start off by introducing, as per usual, foot legend Air Japes. Hello.
Hello, Ben. Happy to be back.
Yeah, good to have you. We haven't spoken about this, so interested to hear your thoughts. And we also have with us, as you'd also expect, Josh Excels. Hello.
Yes, good to be back. Excited for FC 25. I just hope we can relay these pitch notes authentically and volumetrically capture them in the right way.
Indeed. And we also have someone who we've had on plenty of times before. Good to have him back because I know he's had an early play of FC 25. It is one of the main people, let's say, behind the guide. It's Taz. Hello and welcome.
Hey, Ben. Thanks for having me. I wish I would be as funny as Josh with my introduction.
But it's good to have you, and we'll dive straight into some initial thoughts. Obviously, IQ is a big, big thing, the tactics revamp. There's going to be another pitch note about IQ specifically, so we'll leave that to the end. Let's get some initial reaction, as I said. Josh, you're seeing this information for the first time. It does feel maybe a lighter pitch note than we're used to for a gameplay deep dive.
I think the biggest problem with this deep dive is that, I mean, half of the like pitch notes themselves is focusing on FCIQ that then concludes with, we'll explore more in depth about FCIQ in a later deep dive. And it's like, well, could we not just do it now? I don't know. I feel like I understand that you want to kind of do your marketing over a period of time and you don't want to have too much of an overload of information, but especially with the way leaks are as well, a lot of people already know most of the information. I would also say, I think gameplay deep dives or any kind of gameplay update release is always fighting against this thing of, well, there's nothing new. And aside from like making the players fly, I don't really know what it is that people want that's new. You know, if they came out and said, we've not really changed the gameplay that much, but we've just fixed the biggest problems with last year's gameplay, people would complain then that we're not getting new gameplay. And so I don't know. I feel like they're always in a bit of a catch-22. I feel like this struck the right balance. They're not really altering too much of the gameplay, although we will come on to some, I think, quite important changes that were very far down in the pitch notes and weren't really mentioned too much, but also have added new things in terms of the IQ and like goalkeeper play styles, all those kind of big ticket things that they've told us about. So yeah, I mean, every new bit of FC 25 information that comes out, that kind of interest and hype just starts building for it. I think people often build these things up, maybe expecting a bit too much from them. Obviously the Ultimate Team deep dive tends to be a bit longer and that's the thing that people look forward to. And yeah, I'm not expecting anything massive in terms of changes with the gameplay for FC 25, but I think the changes that they've said they're making are in the right areas, moving in the right direction.
Mm. Yeah. And then for you, Japes, if it is the case that really the main thing they've put time into is IQ, the new tactics revamp, and actually Rush as well, because that was a gameplay team project, is that fine? Are you happy to have a year where the impact on gameplay overall is a bit less than it has been in past cycles?
Totally. I mean, if I like holistically look at this past year, what are the main complaints that we have on this podcast, right? Like there's like a few mechanics that maybe we don't love, but it's like the 4-3-2-1, right? Like that, the AI and like association with that, we're like, oh, it's broken, it's repetitive. That's the same thing over and over. So like, imagine a world where AI starts interacting differently because of IQ and they all of a sudden different spaces open up and you can create space in a different way. But like the game mechanics, I would say like we played this game for a long time this year, like a lot of games for a long time. I don't know if that would, like what I mean by long time is like far into the cycle, and sure, it helps having the Euro and the Copa, but I don't know if I could say that certainly for other years. And I don't know if the volume of games I was like as happy to play. So if you're telling me that I can add more of a personal stamp and make it feel more like football-like with many of the similar mechanics. And you're adding in a new, like, pure fun style game mode. Like, I'm good with that. I'm good with it.
Yeah. Just a reminder that you did say you wanted to make children cry in that mode last week.
Yeah. Okay. Fun for me. Fun for me. The thing is, with having two young boys, I deal with children crying all the time.
And Taz, what about you? Would you agree with that in terms of an overall look ahead to 25?
Yeah, I agree to Japes here. I feel like it cannot be underestimated how
smart man
how big the impact and change of IQ is to the game, because it's not only just we're changing a little bit of the custom tactics and how you set it up, but the overall feeling in the game, how the teammates are moving into space and what kind of areas will be dense and congested or not, which was like one of the main, would say, pain points of FC24. We removed work rates, or like they removed work rates. I didn't do it. So I think there's the game itself, just by overworking or like overhauling the whole AI aspect in terms of tactics, the implications on the gameplay experience will be huge.
Yeah, I think that's a fair assessment. And Taz, actually, I wanted to ask you, because we've spoken about this a little bit.
Mm.
How are you feeling about professional fouls being added into the game? This is, for those who don't know, something you can trigger using RB and A, or R1 and X. Is that a good thing to some extent, or is it going to encourage people to be a bit, toxic?
I'm a little bit unsure. I feel like it's a little bit blown out of proportion how the community reacted to it, because I think you most likely have to be really close. And on the other side, it's a guaranteed yellow card. If it's going to be the last man, it's going to be a guaranteed red card. So I feel like some people are just going to be a little bit too loose with it. And hopefully there will be enough downside to it just because of that.
The more I've thought about this, I have like no issue with the yellow card foul and transition and the guarantee. But I feel like if you're like, people are going to take a red card and then quit, like, intentionally. Like, you're through on goal late. And like, I know they're, you know, kind of addressing that. But I like, I think I kind of feel like I want them to like directionally have to execute a slide tackle appropriately or something like that to be able to take me down when I'm through on goal. I don't know. The more I like think about this, the more I feel like it's just gonna end up feeling really annoying if it feels that automatic.
I think when you're close enough to really connect with a slide tackle, you will so you have to be really close to be reliable with a slide tackle. And I feel like I would assume that for professional fouls, you have to be somewhat close. It's not like that we're going to play wrestling where you're going to dive and pull down the opponent's player. So you have to be really close to pull them down. And I think in that range, you're also quite reliable with the slide tackles in itself. So I feel like the change, personally, I would say it's not as huge.
It has been very interesting to see the reaction to this edition. And I understand the kind of trepidation with which it's being treated, because like, as much as we want a real football game representation, this feels like one of those things you don't need to add in. But what I will say is, there have been times where, let's say out on a wing, I've wanted to take a yellow card and just slide through the back of somebody, and I've executed a perfect slide tackle, including those hard slide tackles. And when you watch it back on the replay, the player's legs just kind of bend away from your slide tackle in the air so that they don't fall over. I personally would sooner they fix that than add in some extra like thing that's, in my opinion, unnecessary to allow you to do exactly what I'm trying to do there anyway. I will say, like, it will annoy people an awful lot in a tight game, whether they're one goal down or it's a draw and they're going through on goal in the 90th minute and get pulled down for a red card. That is going to frustrate people. And that's the situation where I don't think it was a necessary addition. If the circle to perform it is close, very close, as Taz is saying, and that a slide tackle would probably have accomplished it anyway, I'm less anxious about it in the game. I think people, there's a certain reactors to current FC25 news that have read one article that says it's an automatic yellow card, and if you do it enough times, it'll be a red card. Like, that article is clearly wrong. If you do it when through in on goal, one-on-one, it's going to be a red card. Like, that's the rule, and that's how it's going to be implemented. So it will be a frustrating mechanic, I think, when it's done in certain times of the game. I don't think it's totally necessary, but I really don't think it's this end of the world thing that it's being made out to be.
Yeah, I think the implementation for through on goal situations is really important. Yeah, it's going to be a red card, but as Japes is saying, it would be frustrating if this was an easy way to stop someone going through on goal and scoring. The way that I think it is useful is as a way of breaking down your opponent's counters without risking a red card by sliding them. Because it's something that the best players do very well, is taking those professional fouls when they need to. You know, you think of Rodri. There are plenty of other examples as well. And not having that in the game, I think, has always given the advantage to the attacking, countering team in a lot of situations, and has made countering more effective overall than it probably should be, maybe. So I think the idea is good. It just comes down to the implementation, whether it is an easy way to grief opponents, essentially. And if it isn't, then I think it will be good. And hopefully that's the case. Right, we're going to take a break here, actually, and we'll come back to talk fairly extensively about goalkeepers, because they have had quite a few changes in 25, including Playstyles Plus. We'll get into that just after this. Hello, welcome back after break. Right, let's talk about goalkeepers. Let's start off talking about playstyles. And we have, what is it, 6 new playstyles. I say new, you might recognize the symbols, but the base playstyles as they existed in Ultimate Team have been essentially revamped and made regular playstyles, proper regular playstyles, and into Playstyle Pluses as well. So just to quickly run through, it's quite obvious really what they do from the title of the playstyle. So you've got footwork, you know, saves with feet basically, rush out, so the keeper charging. You've got deflector, which is to do with clearing the ball out of dangerous areas when making saves. You've got cross claimer, which is obviously about goalkeepers retrieving the ball in the air, and far reach, which is about the reach distance of saves, and far throw, which is being able to just chuck the ball really far. With good speed as well, actually, it says. So that's a little summary. I mean, I think it's something that we anticipated happening, considering there weren't any in 24. Let's come to you first, Taz. Any particular feelings about goalkeeper playstyles at this point?
Yeah, for me, it's a little bit confusing how it was all set up in FC24 with the some goalkeepers. Like, they have playstyles, but they are not really similar to the playstyles of field players. Anyways, now they are fully integrated into the game. Looks good to me. Like, when we talk about the specific game playstyles, something that I felt quite interesting was, for example, the deflector playstyle, because the goalkeeper can consider control where the ball is going to end up after a save.
Yeah, that is a really interesting one. Josh, any for you that stand out?
Cross claimer and rush out are two that I'm going to be interested in seeing. You know, right now we have a kind of high ball meta. And I wonder if cross claimer would become super important, how important it might be at corners, especially with the new corner tactics that we have. So, you know, far reach, like allowing people to save shots further away from them than they would do otherwise. I don't know. We're getting into a slight realm of like superhero power-ups that I'm not quite sure I like. I did think goalkeepers needed playstyle pluses, but it's one of those areas of the game that I think is so specific compared to everything else and so different that it maybe highlights some of the issues with a play style system in this way.
I guess, really, Japes, it's one of those things where it needs us to be using them. We need time to see the effects, and on different goalkeepers, different size goalkeepers, all that kind of stuff. It's quite hard to predict how it's going to pan out at this point.
We'll just like get a feel for it in when it's like in action. What I'm really hopeful is that gives the net outcome is goalkeepers feel like they have more personality, and you're able to select keepers with specific play styles that feel stronger based on the type of shots that you tend to give up. Because that would be, that would feel like good early on, especially.
Yeah, I'm personally interested in the goalkeeper rush playstyle plus. As someone who likes to charge my keeper out because I've probably been caught in behind trying to be too aggressive, the idea of that being something that could bail me out of a few one versus one situations is something I'm quite looking forward to. And there's also something else they've added which can help in that situation as well. I know, Taz, you said to me before you recorded, it's something you wanted to mention because you've actually been able to try it out, and it's something that I think people will get into using if they're, you know, the kind of player who likes to learn a new mechanic.
Yeah, I haven't actually tried it out, but I've seen an example of it because unfortunately the Pitch Notes article doesn't have a video example of it, of the new goalkeeper rush to contain. But so I just want to briefly explain what's happening here. The goalkeeper is coming out of the goal, but is not fully committing on actually picking up the ball or getting it away from the attacker, but is just trying to stay in front of the attacker, which gives another tool or another mechanic to handle those one versus one situations, for example. And I think as the attacker now, you have to, because right now as the attacker, when the goalkeeper is coming out and you recognize that early enough, you will just try to beat the goalkeeper, but just getting around the goalkeeper, for example, with a ball roll or just with a full-on sprint to the side, something like this, which is like a guaranteed if you're early enough with the anticipation on how you have to approach the goalkeeper. But with this new mechanic, goalkeeper rush to contain, I think now you have another tool as the defending player to handle those one versus one situations. And once again, it comes down to having an understanding what is the opponent likely going to do and how I can surprise them. Sometimes you will just rush out with a goalkeeper. Sometimes you will goalkeeper rush to contain. And then you can really surprise potentially the attacker and increase the chances of them missing this big chance. And that's, I feel like it was a little bit overlooked because it was just like basically, I don't know, two lines in the Pitch Notes article without any further examples or explanations. So it can be easily missed when you read through the Pitch Notes that this is a very interesting mechanic.
Yeah, it is really interesting. And it is something that I think has the potential to be quite effective, especially if your goalkeeper had something like saves with feet or I guess footwork plus, and can make those saves as the player tries to take the shot round you or under you. And also it's notable that when you do rush to contain, it brings the goalkeeper out to a certain point, a sort of preset distance from the attacking player, and then stops. But you can then hold the bring out goalkeeper button again to pick your moment to push closer and then collect the ball. So there's a bit more, I guess, nuance to keeper charges this cycle, which should be interesting. Is there anything else on goalkeepers that people want to mention?
Just a clarification on goalkeeper movement, that now you can only take 1 to 2 steps in any direction. I know we got that in the community pitch notes, but it had a bit more detail here, although they didn't include the video, which I thought was interesting. But yeah, like I'm glad that they've added in the rush to contain with that reduction in goalkeeper movement. I think part of the reason some people use goalkeeper movement is that when you brought the goalkeeper out, they were like a homing missile that was just always slightly behind its target. Like the ball was moving to the right and they were still going where it was like a second ago. And that was why it was so easy to dribble around them. So yeah, I'm hopeful that, again, all these things are all about balance. Like one-on-one should still be relatively easy to score because they are in real football. But, you know, if you've still got some element of skill that isn't ridiculous in the way that I think keeper movement has been in how you control your goalkeeper, then I think that can only be a good thing.
Yeah. One thing I was thinking that I hope they can do from a balance perspective is maybe improve chip shots a bit, because...
Somebody say chips?
Yeah. Well, if you have rush to contain where you're bringing a keeper out to a certain distance away from the player, you'd think that's a really good opportunity to do chip shots. But, you know, chip shot plus, maybe it'd be fine, but it feels like apart from that, you get a defender on the line a lot of the time because the distance trajectory wasn't quite right on them. So we'll see whether that changes too. Let me move us on to something very related then, and that's shooting accuracy changes. I'll just read this bit again because I think the actual line is kind of important. they've said that they are changing or updating the accuracy of shots. They'll now more closely mirror the real-life abilities of players, their play styles, and the specific situations they find themselves in during a match. Players can expect that taking shots in difficult situations will feel more challenging, with new animations added to showcase off-balance and tough angle shots. Interesting, Japes. As the resident shooting experts, obviously using precision shooting for a long time, they've said this is a significant change, actually. That's their words. How do you imagine this changing things? Do you think it's a concern? Do you think it's good? Like, I don't know.
Frankly, I'm kind of excited about it slash not super worried about it. What I mean is, like, if you're a smart player and your shot selection's pretty good, that should benefit you.
Mm.
Like, think about all the times that people score goals on you and you're like, that is like an absolutely horrid shot to try to take. Like, what is happening? Or you're like, I'm all over him. I don't understand how that's happening. That impacts that a little bit. Like, as a once upon a time defender, the idea that now you could perhaps get your opponent into a situation to put them off just enough, as you might see in the real game.
Mm.
I'm into it.
Mm.
What you're saying is it's authentic.
Those are not my words. But you might describe my interpretation as something that could be authentic.
I think this is one of the few sections they don't use authentic, actually, but it does sound very authentic, yeah. I know, actually, Taz, you've been using precision shooting since very, very early in the game as well. Any particular thoughts on this section? Or we can move on to passing, to be honest, because that's basically the same words, really, but just about passing.
I feel about both of those sentences or like texts the same. For me, it's like, yeah, this should be more or less the standard, like what you would expect from a good, some sort of a simulation or a game that you're playing, that you'll get more rewarded for if you go for a good setup, doesn't matter if it's a pass or a shot, and that you get punished or like a little bit of a problem if you pass from a position with pressure or like on a bad angle. So for me, this is somewhat more like the bare minimum, I would say. And this is something that we teach all the time, that like, if you see how you play FIFA and FC over the years, it's a numbers game. And you, like, it's a game of variance. And you, as the player, you have the mission or like the target that you go for the execution, that you reduce the variance to the best outcome of yourself. So what you should always try is to, and you have to find a balance between reducing the variance by setting up in the right positions, but on the other side also, when you have a good position, to just take advantage of it and take a little bit of risk. So when it comes to just those fundamental aspects of passing and shooting, I would hope that if you play those passes from a bad angle and with pressure of the opponent, that you have such a spread that you cannot really have this kind of reliability of all those passes connect to your teammate. So I like those changes, and I feel like they should be somewhat in the game earlier, if not that late, to be honest.
Yeah, I agree. I think actually it feels weird that we're just seeing them talk about this now, considering actually one of the big frustrations people have had, and actually they haven't really spoken about it in this way, is when shots go in from situations where they feel like they shouldn't, and this hopefully will mitigate that somewhat. And it's similar for passing, basically. They've said similar things. So this is something that, similar things, saying that they've added new animations for high power passes at tight angles to add variety and realism. They've added and refreshed new animations for high power passes made at tight angles. Our intent here is to add variety and realism, making difficult passes look and feel more authentic, of course. And the concept is basically the same, but this does mean for players under pressure, passing at slightly odd angles, you're probably going to struggle a bit more, maybe. And Josh, I know we've heard a lot from players, especially those, you know, who are, let's say, sort of 11 wins in champs, that kind of tier, that actually pressure is something that they really struggle with already. So do you think they're going to find it more difficult as a result of this change?
Again, that's one of those balancing issues, I think. And there's a part of this where I wonder how much of this is an effort to make play styles. And this relates into FCIQ a little bit, but I wonder how much of it is to make play styles more important. Can you make these passes more accurately if you've got tiki-taka, press-proven, first touch, you know, if you're doing those things, is that error mitigated a little bit so that actually you have that player in midfield and you know you can fire it into them in a tight space and get them to play a quick kind of 90 degree pass out of it? Similar to the animation that we've seen of the long ball having more error, specifically switching from wing back to wing back, it was too easy to do, especially with players with low passing stats and with no long ball trait. I'm sure if you have the long ball trait and have decent long passing, you'll still be able to execute those passes at a decent level. But what it seems to me is an effort to make players feel more individual, mean that you have to play slightly more percentage balls. And there's another aspect to this, again, which relates into FCIQ. Is pressure going to be as much of an issue when you can set up a tactic that would negate some of the pressure that comes in, that can create a spare man, that can create a way of playing for you to get out of high pressure tactics? And is pressure going to work the same as it has done this year? Because, you know, it felt like it was a big issue for the opening of the game. They definitely toned it down in a patch, and then it felt like they kind of did a patch where they forgot the last update they did, because then pressure suddenly came back and everyone's running 100 depth now. So yeah, I do hope that it doesn't make pressure tactics even more powerful, or that pressure tactics will take a nerf that just hasn't really been mentioned, or even that FCIQ allows you to tactically play around a press in a better way. So I don't think it's something to worry about. I think with a lot of these things, it's very easy to worry about the potential negatives without seeing the potential positives. But really, until we get our hands on it, it's impossible to say whether it's going to affect things positively or negatively. You know, as much as EA do a lot of playtesting, and I'm sure we'll get the beta coming in August that'll have a lot of playtesting, you know, there's only so much you can legitimately do. And like, when, you know, millions of people suddenly start playing the game, you are going to see things that are maybe slightly more overpowered than others. And that's where the patches come in that need to balance things.
Yeah. And I would say there's one positive line in this that may be a comfort for people who are, you know, worried about the pressing element. It says this change also ensures that good situations where you make smart tactical decisions will yield better results, truly rewarding your football acumen. Because I think there were criticisms of the fact that realistically you weren't having to play particularly smart to get out of pressure. There were sort of dumb things that you could do which would make it easier, like just flipping the ball across the pitch with players who weren't particularly great at doing that. So, you know, we'll see. There are also, of course, changes to tactics. You can't set press after possession loss or constant pressure without also changing your defensive line, essentially. So that may actually mitigate some of the complaints people have about pressure in 24. On that note, though, we're going to take a quick break here and come back with a couple more gameplay changes, which are well worth mentioning, and maybe a bit about Rush as well, seeing as we've just had a pitch note. We'll catch you in just a second. Hello, listeners. A quick reminder that this podcast is made possible through the generosity of supporters out there. And actually, they aren't just doing it out of the kindness of their heart, because you get a whole extra podcast every single week as a supporter. And you can sign up for a 7-day free trial right now over on Patreon. And after that, it's just £3 a month to continue supporting. It makes a huge difference. The podcast for a time wasn't able to be weekly because I had other work commitments, but this has made it possible to deliver a podcast every single week. And in fact, an extra one too, just for supporters, as I mentioned. So if that interests you and you want that extra content, and actually, if you would like even more, there's the supporter Discord at the gold tier. There is the Hall of Fame at the end of the podcast in the icon tier. There are loads of perks available. So why not check it out if you haven't done so already by searching Support for Weekly or following the link in the description of this podcast. If you consider doing so, that would be hugely appreciated. And a big thank you to all those supporters, as I said, keeping the podcast going and keeping Foot Weekly weekly. Right, let's get back into the pod. Hello, welcome back after the break. Right, let's dive in and cover a couple of other gameplay elements that people wanted to bring up. Josh, I know you wanted to talk about the first touch playstyle changes.
Yeah, it was just like a little line that was quite low down in the pitch notes that said that they were adding new animations to First Touch play style specifically. So it was new animations were added for First Touches for both ground and aerial passes. And I've really enjoyed the First Touch play style this year. I think it's one that is underrated, and hopefully this will give it a bit of a buff, and I think it might be quite an important play style to have next year in terms of dribbling on the ball, RIP orbit dribble. That has been removed, which is a bit sad. And there's a new let ball run improvements, which is the, this year I think it's just holding R1, whereas next year there's like an on-request animation. Instead of waiting for the ball to reach you, you can kind of start running away from the ball to kind of take it in your stride. So it'll be interesting to see if either of those kind of changes affect how people move on the ball, how people take first touches and or don't, and just let the ball run.
Yeah, I can actually see that being quite useful in Rush, that, because allowing the ball to run itself, especially if someone's played, I don't know, a more manual pass to you, for example, which is advantageous when you're playing with humans, letting it run a bit and using the momentum to, you know, accelerate off the ball and then catching the ball up is actually something that could be quite helpful. And also, obviously, deception is so important in a smaller-sided mode that I think actually, yeah, as you say, could be something to look out for. I would say, having played the game, maybe I'll get into this a bit more in the future, but dribbling does feel different. There is a more natural movement when you're dribbling. And I think people who dribble in an authentic, to use that word again, way, will actually find that they enjoy this dribbling system much more. And you can't sort of break animations in the same way you used to be able to. And they've added some kind of shimmy style skill moves, which I think are going to help maybe compensate for what people were previously doing with dribbling, to kind of cause those animation breaks and do it in a more natural way through skill moves. So that'll be interesting to see develop how people, you know, utilize that in different ways. Taz, anything else you wanted to bring up before we move on?
Yeah, I found it really interesting that they actually removed orbit dribble. I feel like it's the right decision, but they just introduced this kind of mechanic with FC24. And I think it's potentially the first time that they introduced the mechanic, and just right away, next title, next version, they just removed it. And I feel like this illustrates quite well that there were not many people who actually used it. I feel like most likely 9 out of 10 players actually turned it off, and the 10% who had it turned on actually never used it. So I think that this is kind of crazy that they just went ahead and just removed it.
Yeah.
Because I think it also caused in the beginning some sort of problems of some display errors, or like a little bit of lags and stuff like this.
Maybe they figured that they were going to have more problems with it than were actually worth it longer term. I actually think fair play to them for doing that, for being kind of,
I agree,
you know, firm about it, because they only have so many buttons that they can use for different things. And so freeing some up, I think, is good. The other thing I know you were keen to talk about, Taz, is the reaction time modifier. They continuously add things to help player switching because they know it's a huge complaint from the community, and fair play to them. They've done a lot over the years to try and change things. This is interesting, and it's actually more for just the LB or L1 switching, not for, you know, the right stick switching. Do you think you could explain this a little bit and maybe how it might help people?
Yeah, like I can read off first of the what is written down in the pitch notes. Like, reaction time modifier added a new setting to help compensate for the speed in which the next player switch changes to allow you to calibrate to your needs. And I, yeah, it sounds very complicated.
So clear. I know exactly what it does now.
Yeah. Okay. Then go ahead and explain it to me. No, I have an idea what it means. I hadn't had the chance to try it out, but I think probably everybody can relate to the situation that you saw the segment indicator, or like the second indicator about above a player. You want to switch to this player, but then just in this moment, it switches to another one, and then you get a player which you were not prepared for. And with this reaction time modifier, you can add a delay to this, which means that even though the segment indicator is to another player already switched, you will still get the player that you probably recognize that the segment indicator is there. So it can help to avoid those kind of situations where you press the L1 or LB button to switch to a player which then all of a sudden surprises you because you end up with another player, because in the meantime it switched to it. Mm. And I have the hope that it helps, but on the other side, I had this kind of hope for a lot of settings in the last couple of years, especially the right stick sensitivity and how the second man indicator is assigned to a player. And I noticed, like, especially with those changes for FC24, for example, with the changes that I just explained, that all of those mechanics and what kind of settings you make, they have advantages and disadvantages depending on the situation. And there is, for me at least, nothing that really stands out for me, which I feel like, well, this is superior for how I play. And I hope this is not the case also for this setting, because I can definitely relate to this kind of situation that this happens. And I hope there's some sort of a sweet spot where you say, okay, now it is perfect that it's not too much delay, but still you don't have those kind of weird situations coming up where you feel somewhat lost where the switch is going to happen. So, but I don't know if this is actually the case.
Mm. I will say, like, having done a lot of editing of footage of people playing FC24, I have like a library of these clips where somebody's trying to select a defender, and with the controller on the screen, you see just as they press it, the second man press indicator or the next switch indicator switches to the next player just as they go and press it. And the amount of times it happens in sequence where you switch three times and every time it moves just before is absolutely mind-blowing. And so I'm really glad if that fixes that problem. It doesn't need to be a long delay. It's literally like two or three frames in the game where that change can happen. If it fixes that problem, as Taz says, it will be a massive, massive improvement to that RB switching.
Yeah, I get what they're trying to do, right? It's all about adding more tools for people to be able to make player switching more suited to them. And I think Japes and I have talked about using the right stick switch sensitivity, reducing that and actually that being effective. So I think they are making a difference in this area, but yeah, it's taking a bit of time to do that. Let's just move on at the end here. Is there anything, Taz, as you're not on the pod so often, is there anything that you feel was a bit of a missed opportunity for 25 that you feel like they could have added or changed or made an addition? I know, for example, a lot of people thought that the fact there were going to be new playstyle pluses meant that there would be outfield playstyles, but that isn't something we're seeing. It's just goalkeeper ones.
Yeah, exactly. I felt like playstyles had such a huge impact and influence on FC24, and I was very surprised when I heard that there are no new playstyles for outfield players, because I feel like there is some sort of opportunity, especially when it comes to shooting. Like, I have two playstyles in mind, which I feel like could have been easily integrated into the game. For example, something like a low-driven finisher, like someone who then has harder or like more accurate shots when the player is shooting low, for example. Mm. Or another one, which I feel like could be some sort in the game, something like either rock-solid finisher or like clinical finisher, someone who can still finish tremendously well when they are under pressure, for example, from an opponent's defender. So I feel like just covering this aspect, and I feel like if you think about it more, you will come up with at least like one or two playstyles for each of those areas that we have currently. And yeah, I feel like this could be have something to also add to the game.
Yeah, the problem is if you look at the playstyles in the menus,
yeah,
they've not got enough space to fit them in, have they?
That's right.
That's why I'm getting playstyles for goalkeepers. They kind of already had them sort of, but not really. Nice. Well, actually, Taz, before we wrap up on the gameplay pitch notes, and I would just say there are plenty more changes. You can go and listen to me reading through the gameplay pitch notes if you like for the full lowdown on this. But as I said, we wouldn't talk too much about IQ. We'd talk more about it in future. But Taz, it'd be interesting to hear what you make of it, whether you think it's the right approach, whether you think it's, you know, going to be something that is positive for the game overall.
I mean, I'm not going to briefly just explain what FC IQ is, because this is way too much, as you can see with the space it got in the gameplay deep dive. But
yeah, I think I've explained it like three times on the podcast, yeah. And I'm sure people still don't know what it is.
What is it?
Yeah. Oh, there are changes to tactics? Really? No. like, first of all, I think this kind of change, like how the tactics, like the approach to it is really cool that you now have this kind of transition between without the ball and with ball. And I feel like this represents modern football very well. And I feel like this is a really cool approach, because you can also tell from how, like, we were setting up now tactics in FIFA 23 and FC 24. I think in FIFA 23, we had for the first time this kind of change of like the 4-3-2-1, where you play it defensively as a 4-4-2, for example. And I feel like, oh, obviously this kind of formation caused a lot of problems or like a lot of frustration now in FC 24. But I think this kind of making this happen on a regular basis, where you can really set up so many different combinations and ways of playing, is pretty cool. But on the other side, I am really afraid of this, that this can actually break the game, because we can see how effective those certain tactics were already now with this like limited ways on how we can set it up. And I'm a little bit afraid of like how much players we have and how much players are willing to really go beyond and invest so much time to find this one broken thing. And I am afraid this is going to take like only 1 or 2 weeks until we get the first really broken tactics. And I hope that they really tested those like different extremes, for example, to some extent, that this is not as easy to find, because otherwise this can be really rough. FCIQ has to be tested to full extent to make sure that it's not, that it can't break the game as easily, because otherwise we are in for a really hard time.
Yeah. So I actually think we won't see anything broken in the first like half of the year. Maybe. But like, just because I believe that there are so few plus players for like specific tactics that it's just going to be, I guess maybe that's not true. Maybe somebody figures out some like plus combo with the roles and the IQ that's entirely broken, and it just has this massive impact on the market. But I believe there are so many combos of players that might have plus but not be plus in terms of like what you can actually feel might be broken, or what's needed from players to actually feel broken, that I just don't think there's going to be the depth of, what do they call it? Foot items, i.e. cards, to be able to like build something truly broken off the start.
Yeah, again, it is all about the balance. As I said earlier, we did have the rush pitch note. Wanted to just quickly cover that. We'll get the full ultimate team implementation information in time, I'm sure, because there wasn't that much in this. So for now, it'd be interesting to hear from you, Japes. You watched the video. What did you make of how it was sold in that?
I think they did a pretty good job selling it. Like, it looks fun to me. I think there's going to be, like, we like to talk about skill gap. Oh gosh, do I think the skill gap's going to be beefy? Because it looks like, it looks like finishing looks like normal finishing.
It is.
Just like in Rush. And that means that people are going to actually have to figure out how to appropriately manually defend.
Ooh.
Mm-mm. Which might be good for the overall player base, but it's going to be really, really hard for people to begin with, because if you can't manually defend very well, you're going to be giving up tons of space for easy shots. And it's an AI, it's not a pro clubs keeper, it's an AI keeper who's still going to like lose out to finesse shot plus every single time. Not every time, maybe not every time, but you get what I mean. So, you know, I think that's going to be interesting. But I think I think they did a really nice job of showing how it's incorporated into all of the different modes.
Mm.
I think the selection of players looks nice.
Yeah, this is something we haven't seen before. So, and you haven't seen it either, have you? I know you.
No, I've not
played Rush, but you haven't seen the Ultimate Team implementation. So you can see people drafting their players to go in together.
Yeah, you can see like what everybody else has selected. It looks like it does some selected players for you, which I don't know.
Yeah, sort of pre-selects a group of players that might be the ones you want to.
Yeah,
pick.
I don't know how that works.
But you can then search your club for, you know, whoever.
Yeah,
you
want. It shows 22 seconds, so I'd imagine you have 30 seconds to select your player.
Mm.
And it's nice that the bonuses on the screen are just like right there. Like it's a very clean UI in my mind for how it looks. So I'm pretty excited for this game mode. Now I just got to figure out how to find people that want to play with me.
And what about you, Josh, from the visuals? You know, getting you more excited? I know you're pretty excited anyway.
Yeah, like I think it's everything I wanted it to be. You know, it looks a lot of fun, and that's what I'm looking forward to. I think Japes may struggle to get playing partners who are also looking to make kids cry. But I think people who are looking to have fun may have a little
bit
more.
I've already gotten messages from Who Bear, so look out, world.
There was a great line, actually, in the kind of 3 minute or so video that we got on YouTube, where it was like, it's counteracts the stress of like champs and rivals quite well. It goes along with that quite well. So I'm hopeful that it really does lean into that fun aspect. There's some really interesting innovations in there. The fact you can show where you're running is really cool. And yeah, it's going to take a little while to get used to, I think, though.
I hope that it counteracts that way. But like, there is a different level of frustration watching another user do something absolutely brain dead when you're trying to complete an objective. Like, it's just a different level of like, I guess then people have something to blame.
Exactly. That's why social gaming's the best. It's never my fault.
Yeah, Josh has never been bad at anything his entire life.
Exactly.
Yeah, I'm interested to hear from Taz on this because, like me, you played this pretty early in the development and you hadn't really played, you said, much pro clubs.
No.
You really enjoyed it. I think you were quite buzzing. You were going to start your own pro clubs career at that point.
Yeah, I didn't go through with that, but yeah, I think it's a complete new dimension for me, to be totally honest, like, because for the last couple of years, or like almost a decade now, I just almost exclusively playing FIFA and FC on a solo mission, basically. And now, yeah, with the upcoming title for the first time in Ultimate Team, because I didn't play any co-op in Ultimate Team, it didn't really interest me as much. Now there's a complete new experience with the integration of Rush into Ultimate Team, and I'm a little bit excited about how this is going to show, because I have some, like, obviously the colleagues of the guides of my team, we're working on education and content. For us, it's a complete new way of playing together and having a good time, while also maybe experimenting a little bit about it.
Yeah. Just let me know when you're searching, because I don't want to play against you. But yeah, it was a lot of fun, you know, when we did play it. But it'll be interesting to see what it's like for people playing drop-ins. I know we had a few questions from people actually about Rush, you know, whether it was something that they saw themselves playing because of the fact that maybe they're not used to playing the game with other people, maybe they don't have a headset, this kind of stuff. And I think we'll come to that again once we talk about Rush and we have that Ultimate Team information. So we'll wrap it up here. Thank you very much to all our guests. First of all, Taz, it's been nice to have you back on the pod. Thank you very much for coming on.
Oh, for sure. It was a lot of fun to talk about FC25 and the upcoming changes. Thanks for having me.
It's been good to have you. Hopefully we'll have you back before launch. And thank you very much to Josh for joining us. Been good to have you too.
Yeah, it's been great. I can't wait to play it now.
Yeah. Everyone praying for beta codes, I'm sure. And thank you very much to Japes as well. Great to have you on.
Cheers.
And of course, thank you to all you listeners tuning in. A reminder that it is a great idea to subscribe via the various different podcast platforms, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, on YouTube, for example, especially as releases are going to be less consistent in terms of their scheduling over the summer. So always good to be subscribed so you hear about a new episode as it drops. And of course, if you would like extra podcast content throughout the summer, then do join the Patreon supporters. It's just £3 a month and you get double the podcast content. Just search Support Foot Weekly. And a big thank you to those supporters for supporting the podcast and keeping it going, including those icon patrons: Dave B, Hugh J, Darren W, Alistair M, Dom P, Rob P, Jeff B, Damon H, Tom B, Adam G, Neil P, Alex M, Jake S, Dan W, Roger D, Lee A, Andrew C, Nishant, Waterman, Dylan H, Adam R, Rob L, Brendan W, Michael K, David G, Jimmy K, Cherry Drank, John D, Michael B, Aditya S, and Joshua K. Plus a special thanks to Luke M, Dave B, Hugh J, Tom M, Darren W, and Pato Foot for advice and production assistance. Before I leave you, just one more thing to add though. Ultimate Team is a bit like life really. It has its many ups and downs. If you're having a few more downs than ups in real life in these more difficult times, then please don't feel that you're alone or need to struggle on without taking action. If you go to thecalmzone.net, there's loads of resources, advice, support, or even just a friendly chat for anyone who needs it. If it sounds like it could help you, then head over to thecalmzone.net. And for now, have a good one, and I'll catch you on the next podcast.